السلام ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We are still alhamdulillah in the book of purification. Book of purification. Because this is the preparation for the most important thing for the Muslim, which is prayer, salah. طيب. Somebody maybe fix this condition. I don't know how to do it. Now you turn it off. Maybe you need to. Last time we started about menstruation, and then we explained the difference between hayd and istihara, menstruation and irregular blood that's come, and we said that for the lady to differentiate between the two types of blood, then either that she has a habit that she knows that her menses stays for a certain period, like 5 days, 7 days, maybe 10, maybe more or less, but she is used and she knows from her regular experience that this menses last with her for this period of time. So this is one way to for her to know that this is menstruation. Right. The other thing we said that a lady may know this from the types of blood that comes, either because it is thick. You know, it's not like regular blood that's running blood, but it's thick, it's turned to dark mostly, and it has certain smell. So the woman knows that this type of blood is in fact was a menses. طيب. Today we'll go to the third way to for the lady to know what's the difference between these two types of blood. So when a woman has neither a regular menstrual period nor a distinguished kind of blood, and these are the two things that we explained last week, such a woman must follow the relevant womanly menstrual period. That means go with what? With the average. And the average period of time that most women encounter with their menstruation is, as the Sheikh said, average of 6 or 7 days a month. This is the average. As we said, some of them less and some of them more than this. And deem whatever discharge after this period as istihara. So, after this 7 days, if she couldn't distinguish, you know, and she realized if she didn't know if this blood is istihara or hayd, then after 7 days, then we'll consider any blood that's come after the period of 7 days is what? As istihar. That even the blood is still running, what should she do? She take ghusl and resume her prayers and fasting. طيب. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said to Hamna binti Jahsh. Hamna, one of the Sahabiyat, salam rahmatullah, the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave this advice. And as we said, that we learn from the instruction the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to a people who asking him. This is very important, brothers. This is very important because we should understand that the answer of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam for anyone is applicable to anybody else unless there is what? There is dalil or proof that restricted this matter to this person. Clear? So the answer was to this lady, but we learn from this. So what he said to her? He said this istihada, that's mean referring to istihada, is a strike or caused by shaitan, so you should count 6 or 7 days for menstruation, then you should take ritual bath, that's mean ghusl. If you see that you have purified yourself, then perform prayer for 24 or 23 days and fast for this will be sufficient for you. So here, according to this hadith, that six or seven days will be considered in the month as what? As hayd, as menstruation. And the rest of the month will be considered as what? Huh? As pure. Even there is some time that's but coming, it will be counted as istihada. It's not hayd. This hadith is related by 5 compiler of the hadith, which means what? It is a strong hadith and deen sahih. Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi classified this hadith as sahih. Right. To sum up, as we started to review our previous lesson, we said, a woman with a stable, regular menstrual period distinguished istihada according to her habit. If she used, know that she takes 10 days, then she will count 10 days every time. 11 days, same. 5 days, it depends. This is the first time. Second, a woman distinguished blood depend on her own judgment. That means she knows, she realizes, she understands from her experience that this type of blood is not something which is usual. As we said, we distinguish either smell or color. Right? And the third one which we talk about today, a woman has neither regular period nor distinguished blood, is to consider 6 or 7 days. This is what the average woman, you know, stay as in the area or in the time of hayd. Right? The aforementioned ruling combine the 3 rules stated by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Now let's read what the Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said about this matter. He said, there are 6 distinctive features between menstruation and istihada. Again, just to explain for those people who missed maybe last week, what's the difference between menstruation and istihada? We say menstruation called hayd. Hayd. And hayd is the regular monthly period that happens for ladies every month. Tayyib? Istihada is irregular blood that's come, you know, by itself. And this mostly because of veins. It's not really, it's come from the same place where the hayd comes. This is why it is almost like any other blood. So it's like cut in veins. So this is called istihada. The difference between the 2 types, be careful. For hayd, this is what we said, the woman is not considered spiritually pure, because this is considered as hadath akbar, a major impurity, therefore she abstain, stay away from praying, fasting, touching the mushaf, the Quran, or entering the masjid, or having relation. These are 5 things that woman, at the time of her period, should stay away of. On the other side, istihada, it seems like what? Pure woman. So that means she can do everything. Same like any, you know, any other lady, I mean, before this blood come to her. So she can pray, fast, enter the masjid, make tawaf, tayyib. But if there is blood coming, then she should take good care of cleaning herself, you know, every time, you know, before she do any of these ibadat. Is this clear? Right. Here, and we mention how a woman can decide if the blood that's coming, if it is hayd or istihara. Now let's go to what Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said. He said, there are six distinctive features between menstruation and istihara. The first is the regular. The first is the regular stable menstrual period, which is the most reliable distinctive sign. Since we talk about this already, as any discharge other than that of menstruation is regarded as istihara. Any blood that's come after the fixed period that the woman used to have during her period considered as istihara. That means if her regular period is 6 days, you know, whatever blood come after 6 days consider what? Istihara. If her regular period is 10 days, whatever come after these 10 days consider what? Istihara. طيب. Leave a question at the end, please. طيب. The second is the distinguishable blood. As we said before, the malodorous, thick, and black blood is considered with great reason as menstruation. So this is another type. Here, we are not talking about the period, but we're talking about what? About the nature of blood itself. The characteristics of this blood. What type of blood? Is it thick? Smell? Mostly slim, it doesn't smell good. You know, thick, dark, black. That means this is another, you know, sign that it is hayd. The third distinctive is to follow the prevalent womanly menstrual period. This is what we said, the average. And the original juristic rule is that the ruling on the individual follows that on the majority. This is what we call it qa'ida amma. طيب, this is qa'ida amma, general guideline. This is considered as general guideline. If we have rules, طيب, then usually if then any individual, rahmukallah, should follow what? The common and the average thing that's done by people. Right. These three cases are stated in the Sunnah and by means of legal consideration. So this is what the Sheikh said about this matter. Right. Then Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned the remaining three cases, and in his conclusion he said, now the Sheikh did not mention these three, because the Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, he mentioned six, but the Sheikh, he just, you know, mentioned the three that we already discussed. Why? Because here he just want to, you know, emphasize on something which is based on very clear proofs and evidences from the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And then he said, the most valid opinion is to abide by the first three cases as they were stated in Sunnah and to reject the others. This is why the Sheikh did not mention the remaining three. Why? Because Ibn Taymiyyah himself, after he discussed these six, if we should not take the remaining three of the six, why did he discuss it? This is a question. So why the Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, why should he discuss it? You know, Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, he was very, mashallah, had very deep knowledge. And he always addressed any matter that discussed by others to explain to them their errors and their mistakes. So sometimes he reports something even he doesn't consider it as valid, just to what? To tell you that we are aware of this. So no one will come to you and say, no, there are other signs. So he's like saying what? We are aware of these three. But we say don't depend on any more than the three mentioned. Why? Because these three, you know, signs or cases are the one which mentioned in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salat wa salam. Clear? طيب. طيب. Obligatory acts to be observed by mustahada in case she deemed ritually pure. She has to take ritual bath when her estimated period for menstruation ends. طيب. Which means that the menstruated woman, when she, the time of her period over, even the blood is still running, then she take what? The ritual bathing. And deem that she finished the regular period, and now any blood that's come consider as what? As istihada. But she should take a ritual bath. Not saying, I will wait till this blood is over. Otherwise, she cannot pray or fast, you know, unless she took what? Huh? Ritual bathing. And this is what women should do. طيب. She has to wash her, you know, everything, you know, for herself. And then, if there's any blood that's coming, she be careful to use all possible means for this blood not to come out on her clothes or in the place where she prays, especially if she is going to inside the masjid. The masjid. طيب. And it's very important to know why, because especially women who are coming for Umrah. You know, sometimes when ladies, because they come for Umrah, and because, you know, women are weak sometimes, and after they are striving, very tired, so blood may come. Even it's not time for hayat, but blood come as istihara. Therefore, what should she do? She makes sure that she, none of this drop, you know, come on the masjid. طيب. This, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, she should give up her prayer during the menstrual period, after which she should take a bath, and then she can perform prayer. And that means she moved from the, what we call it, impurity to purity. طيب. This is why now she is ready for her prayer and for everything. طيب. Third, the postnatal bleeding, this, the blood that come at the time of what? Of delivering baby. You know, at the time of giving birth to a baby, you know, that's when baby comes, it's come with blood and all these things. And this blood may be running for some time. The same rules which apply on menstruation apply to this blood that's coming. So here we don't consider it as istihada. Be careful. Here, after birth, we don't say just count the average 7 days. Why? Because there is a reason here. There is a reason. And we know what's the reason behind this blood, flowing blood. This because of what? The delivering of the baby, of birth, the baby. طيب. The ruling in woman state is like that of menstruation, one concerning the permissibility, you know, of having relation or praying or fasting. They also have the same ruling regarding repetition of any tawaf or reciting the Quran or staying in the masjid. And we mentioned before that regarding recitation of the Quran, there is different view among ulama. Some of them, they said that the menstruated woman should not recite the Quran because they consider it as hadathun akbar, as a major impurity. But we said that the sound view, that the woman in this period, can she recite the Quran or not? We said yes. Now she can recite the Quran, but should not touch the Mus'haf directly. This is the sound view. Even in many madhab, you know, you will find that they said she should not recite the Quran. And we already discussed this matter before. طيب. طيب, the maximum period, according to this Sheikh's personal reading, is 40 days, according to the majority of scholars. طيب, why 40 days? This is the view that was adopted by the Hanbali. Some ulama, they said, events will go up to 60. 60. طيب, but if in case the woman became cured, I mean clean, after 20 days, there's nothing coming, and the sign of purity was appeared for her, should she stay also for 40 days, or she should resume her ibadah? She should take ritual bathing, ghusl, and resume her ibadah. Because, my dear brothers, this relates to what? The reason. What's the reason? The coming of blood. If it was stopped, and she noticed that she is clean, then she can get from this state, and then she take the ritual bath and the ghusl, and then, you know, continue her regular life. But as we said, some ulama, they said, even after 40 days, and some other, they said, up to 60 days, and some other. But this is the average, which is, and the Sheikh mentioned here, why? Because in the hadith, which was reported by At-Tirmidhi, he said, people of religious knowledge, that's mean ulama, among the Qumman ibn Urwa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the ulama, as-sahaba, radhiyallahu alayhim, and their successors uniformly agree that woman in state of postnatal bleeding must give up prayer for 40 days, unless her bleeding stops before that. In this case, she has to take ritual bath. So here, he limited to 40 days. As we said, this view, na'am, it's not the only view, be careful. Because you'll find, if you find in other books of fiqh or in other matters, they said 50 or 60. So this is something which is an area of what? Debatable matter among the ulama. طيب. So if the bleeding woman is state with طيب, I think witnesses. If a pregnant woman miscarry and start discharging, and the stillborn has reached a distinctly recognized form, she is considered as a woman in the state of natal bleeding. What does this mean? The woman, the pregnant woman, طيب, and then it's become what we call it saqt. Saqt, that means drop, that she dropped her, her embryo. That means come before its normal time. Maybe after 1 month, after 2 months, after 5 months. So, can we, Muslim Rahmatullah, should we consider this as hayd or nifas? This is the point, be careful. We have two situations, hayd or nifas. Hayd is what? Menstruation. طيب. Nifas is?
Postnatal.
طيب. طيب. If the woman discards her baby, how can we deal with her? I mean, or how can she deal with this situation? Should she consider this as hayd, this blood coming hayd, or as postnatal? Here depends on what? On the embryo and the period of time that's come. So if the embryo that's come out, it looks very clear that's like a feature of a human being. And this mostly it's come after 3 months maybe, you know. طيب. Then will be considered as what? As delivering baby.
Nifas.
As nifas. But if it was as a piece of lint, especially in the first few days or weeks, it's not clear that the features of a human being. And then the blood that will come after it will be considered as what? Same as hair. Is this clear? Right. Right. So, as the Sheikh said here, an embryo takes about 81 days to 3 months in order to have the extensively recognized shape. Where did we get this from? We got this from the Hadith. The Hadith. Naam, after the Hadith said between 80 to 120 days. طيب. And this is the period where the form of a human being will be very, very clear here. Right? If the embryo is a mere lump of flesh or clinging without distinct recognizable form, the woman is not considered as in the state of nifas, postnatal bleeding. Even if she starts discharging, she is not to give up prayer or fasting, and none of the ruling postnatal as applicable in this case. As applicable in this case. So therefore, it will be, it must be considered as nifas. طيب, sometimes the problem mixed between hayd and istihada. But here there is no istihada, no hayd. Why? Because the hayd has come, in fact, for the woman, I mean the pregnant woman, she doesn't have menstruation. Because, subhanAllah, this blood is the blood where the embryo grow, depending on this. This is why you notice that pregnant woman doesn't have this circle. And is one of the signs that the woman is pregnant is that she doesn't have the monthly circle. طيب. The Sheikh discussed another matter. This is some who think that many ladies they are doing these days. You know, some women, when Ramadan come, they take birth control pills because this pill prevent blood from coming. Sometimes there's certain medication, you know, that if ladies she took it, she will delay the time of her menstruation. So some women they take it during Ramadan. Why? Because they want to continue and finish Ramadan. They don't want to break their fast. Others, they take it when they go to Hajj or Umrah. They don't want anything to disturb their trip or their journey, so they can finish. طيب, is it permissible or not? Here it depends on the what? On the the situation or the of the woman herself. If such pills doesn't hurt her health, doesn't make any side effect that may prevent her from becoming pregnant in the future, or any reason that cause any damage for her health, and just for to take it for very specific period, not forever, then it is allowed. It is okay, according to the view of some ulama. It is okay. طيب. So this is the point here. So the Sheikh said here, it seems suitable to truly complete our discussion at this point by mentioning that some women may take some kinds of medicine that prevents menstrual bleeding in order to observe fasting in Ramadan or to perform Hajj. Such medications are permissible if they prevent blood only for a period of time, not forever. If this medication prevents menstruation forever, woman not permitted to take it without her husband's permission. What the relation of the husband here? Because that means she may stop having children, and having children is the right of whom? The husband. If you want to have brother. So anyone for women at this time she is allowed to use it, but with what? With the permission of her husband. Here also it's very important to mention that it is not allowed for a Muslim woman or even couple to take any action, take any action that prevent having children. You know, some people what they do, they have what they call it some surgery for either the side of the man or the woman. Mostly men they use it, so they cut certain veins so they will not have children in the future. Anyone who do it forever, this is haram. This is forbidden. It's not allowed. نعم. طيب. Is it allowed to delay it for some times to organize? I mean that there's some time, you know, because some women maybe they have children every year, have a child, baby. طيب. For this lady, we said if she her intention just to wait because of her health, because the parents they want to take rest for, you know, 2 or 3 years to raise the child, the baby, and then they have another child, it is okay, it is allowed. Naam? But anything which is forever, this is haram. My dear brothers, you know, very, very important. These days, many people, unfortunately, they talk about what they call it economic, huh? They count it in economic. They said, you see now these days, there's no work, no job. And you know, spending on children a lot of money, schooling, education, food, clothes. You know, I cannot manage with this. Subhanallah. The one who say this, in fact, he has no trust in Allah Azza wa Jalla. Why? Because this, the reason that prevent many people of disbeliever not to having children, and they kill themselves, you know, their children. قال عز وجل ولا تقتلوا أولادكم خشية إملاق. Don't kill your children because you are afraid of poverty. And subhanAllah, the ayah mentioned twice in the Quran. Sometime one ayah said, Allah yarzukukum wa iyyakum. Allah provide you and them. Another ayah said, Allah yarzukukum wa iyyakum. Allah provide them and you. Yani subhanAllah, because Allah Azza wa Jalla assigned for every, you know, single creature and that he created his provision. Sometimes maybe the father, he have 5 kids and said 5 kids too much. He doesn't know that maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assigned, you know, that very much or more provision for the 6th child. So the coming of this 6th child will be as a blessing for him and for his family. Yes. They don't know. The important thing that we know that Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ. We are the one who provide you. Allah Azza wa Jal, the provider. وَكَيِّمْ مِنْ دَابَ لَا تَحْمِلْ مِرْزُقَ. No. None of the creations. Allah Azza wa Jal carry its provision with itself. Allah Azza wa Jal, who is the one who give this risk. So be careful about this. طيب. طيب. Thus we have briefly highlighted, I think we already talked about this. Do we have time, Sheikh, to move to the next chapter?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So we'll start our main topic for today, which is about prayer. And my dear brothers, prayer in fact is the sign between Islam and Kufr. This mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam very clearly. The ulama never consider any action of ibadat that not doing this ibadah by negligence, not denying, as kufr except salah. Right? Because there's some hadith. Why the salah is very important? My dear brothers, you see, if you look at the way that the salah was prescribed, all the ibadat, the acts of ibadah, all commands that was revealed to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it was revealed, you know, in place in the earth. Na'am? In the way through Jibreel Alayhi Salam. Through Jibreel Alayhi Salam. If you look at the ibadah of Salah, at what time it was prescribed? The Prophet ﷺ was in the earth, in the land, or was in heaven? Subhanallah. The sama. Which sama? Above the 7th. Sama. And it was, he was commanded with Salah by whom? Through Jibreel? by Allah Azawajal directly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to him and commanded him to this prayer. Just this point show you the importance of this salah. Second, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, أول ما يسأل عنه العبد يوم القيامة الصلاة. The first deeds or acts of ibadah that man will be questioned about in the day of judgment, salah, his prayer. فَإِن قُبِلَتْ, not this, فَإِن قُبِلَتْ, if it was accepted, he will be accepted, that means be successful. وَسَائِرُ عَمَلُ وَإِذَا, but if it was rejected, this salah, he will be rejected and all what he did will be vanished. Just to show you the importance of salah. The last also, or the third indication is the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was mentioning this with his last breath before he leave this world. As-salatu as-salah. Wa ma malakat aymanu. As-salatu as-salah. This is showing the importance of salah. So these here, my brothers, that we need to even train our children. We know that salah, it's not must till they reach the age of bulugh. But even though we were commanded to train them and command them, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا, command your family on performing salah. وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا, stubber, that means you should be patient with this matter. Some people, they get tired. You know, the first day, son, go to the masjid. Second day, 3 days, 4 days. Next month, next week. And then, I get tired of this. And the Quran said, وَاسْطَبِرْ, not wasbur, istabir. That means even if you don't have patience, you should be what? Have more patience. Right. Prayer is the most obligatory of the five pillars of Islam, next to the two shahada. And it was ordained in the best and the most perfect way for an act of worship. Prayer includes many of the acts of worship, like the remembrance of Allah, recitation of the Quran, humbly before Allah Azza wa Jal, bowing, prostration, supplication, and takbir. So prayer is also the head of the physical acts of worship. Physical acts of worship. Because we have physical and we have spiritual, which is ibadat al-qalb. Right? Ibadat al-qalbi. Unlike all other acts of worship, was enjoined by Allah and the Prophet Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the night of Al-Isra wa Al-Mi'raj. This is an indication of its greatness, confirmation of its being obligatory, and sign of its high status in the sight of Allah. So this is what we said. There are many hadith indicating that the virtue of Salah and showing its being obligatory fardun on all Muslim individual. This is the ibadah that which is fardu ayn. What's mean fardu ayn? It is must on every Muslim. And there are certain conditions, we'll talk about it later. Right? Every sane adult Muslim, he have to pray. The fact that prayer is an obligatory act of worship is primarily known in Islam. So whoever denies this fact is considered to be apostate, murtad. Anyone who denies the salah will be considered. Is it only salah? Only denying the salah considered as disbelief? Huh? Question. Is it only denying salah?
No.
Denying any of the well-known obligation of the religion will be considered as disbelief. Somebody who denies zakah, same. This is why at the time of Abu Bakr, they considered him as murtaddin, apostate. The difference here, it's very important to know this. We cannot, and always I mention this and emphasize it. It's not for anyone. Be careful and memorize this and keep it in your mind. It is not for anyone to label, tag any Muslim that he is a disbeliever. Even he saw him, he doesn't pray. Get my point? Because some people, what they do, they take the dalil, this dalil, they said, anyone who doesn't pray is not a Muslim. So he doesn't see his neighbor going to the masjid. He never saw him. So he said, this man, you see, he's a kafir. Astaghfirullah. That's not correct. Right? Because there's certain procedure. No one by his own should classify people. This is something that should be go to whom? Huh? The authority. Authority. Why? Because the ulama never label anybody that he is not Muslim just because he was deserting the salah. But they ask, he come to them, maybe he is ignorant. Maybe he doesn't know. طيب, maybe he's confused. I'll give you an example. I met one brother, he's an American. He embraced Islam. He stayed 10 years, he never prayed. After becoming Muslim. 10 years, he told me. And he was very, very, he regrets this. Why? Because he met one Muslim and have discussion with him, and he liked to be Muslim, so he embraced Islam. And the next day, this guy disappeared. He didn't meet him again. And he was living in a small town, as he said. This time, this not these days with the internet and all this. This, about 30 years ago, back when I was a student. And then later on, he met some students who provide him, and they told him about Salah. So some ignorant people, they met this miskin, this old man, and they ask him, Mashallah, you're a Muslim? He said, yes. Okay, do you pray? No. He said, I see, he's not a Muslim. They don't ask. They don't investigate. They don't try to find what the reason. This is why, my brother, it's very, very important that we should, teach our children this matter. It's not allowed for anyone, to label anybody that he's Muslim or not, because this is something that should go to whom? To the authority, because they have certain procedure to decide if he's a Muslim or not. طيب. I think this is like introduction, and then the Sheikh, he mentioned some of the meaning of Salah. What's the meaning of Salah? The word Salah, from Salah or Sal, which means to connect. Anything which connect between two sides, okay, they call it Salah. Like when you talk about our family kinship, what we call it? Silat al-Rahim. Silat. When you talk about connection between two places, we go through Muasalat. Right? When you talk with somebody there, you call it Ittisalat. Not Saudi. Ittisalat. Communication. Right? So this all go to the same root. So Salah is like connection or relation between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right. The word Salah in a meaning, this is a linguistic meaning. But if we talk about, when we talk it about in Islamic term, as Salah to consider as dua, supplication. Right? قال عز وجل فصلي عليهم إن صلاتك سكن الله. Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded Rasulullah Sallam said, make dua for them. Salli alayya. So this is salah, that's mean dua here. This is the type. When we come to the formal salah, that we act like the five prayers. There is definition that every one of us should but memorize this definition. I'm sure Sheikh Abdul Majid knows this. Therefore, I will ask him to tell us. Sheikh Abdul Majid, don't look at the book, look at me. We'll not find it there. Okay. Okay, can you tell them what the definition of the Salah that we said before? And we said this word by Sheikh bin Athameen. Salakat, huh? Yeah.
It's a kind of worship.
Naam.
Starting with takbir.
Naam.
And ending in salam.
And tasleem. Barakallah fi. Naam. Hi, Adilad.
Salah is a dua. It is a direct communication to Allah.
Naam.
It starts with takbir and it will end with tasleem.
Jameel, both are correct. Anybody else? Huh? Hey, listen to this and write it down. As-salatu hiya at-ta'abbudu lillah. This is very important. As-salatu hiya at-ta'abbudu lillah. That means prayer is to worship Allah. To worship Allah. Through, by. Right? Specific, be careful. Specific or certain sayings and actions. That's mean words and acts. Saying and action. Specific saying and action. Which start with takbir. Saying Allahu Akbar, takbir to al-Ihram. Naam. And end in tasleem. Some ulama added this word, they said ala sifatin makhsusa, on a specific way, they're performing this in a specific way. So this definition of what of the salah as ibadah, not the just word, the salah is dua, as word, salah is dua. But when we talk about salah, which is like obligatory obligatory prayer, that we do it when we make takbir and ruku' and sujood and sitting. And this is why he said, أَقْوَالٌ وَأَفْعَالٌ مَخْصُوصٌ. Specific saying, like saying Subhanallah in a sujood, like saying Subhana Rabbil Azim, in Subhana Rabbil Azim in ruku' Subhana Rabbil A'la in sujood. صح؟ saying Rabbi Ghafirli. This is specific saying. We cannot put something from our own. You cannot say, when we say, instead of saying Allahu Akbar, you say, for example, Subhanallah. No. We should say it specifically as it was described for us. Clear? Right. Linguistically, prayer means invocation or dua. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, as we mentioned, salli alayhim and invoke, open them. According to the Sharia or Islamic law, prayer is defined as a special kind of saying and deeds, beginning with takbir and ending with tasleem. But the definition that I gave it to you is more specific and more detailed. And this was the ta'rif or definition that was made by Sheikh bin Uthaymeen, and it is more precise. This would mean it is called prayer because it's include invocation. During prayer, the worshipper is in the state of invocation through worshiping Allah, praising Him, supplicating Him. This is why it is called prayer. As-salatu was decreed by Allah Azza wa Jal fi laylat al-Isra'i wa al-Mi'raj as five prayers to be performed every day, every night and day, at specifying time by every legally accountable Muslim. Allah Azza wa Jal said, inna as-salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaban mawquta. The word kitab here doesn't mean book. Be careful. كتب عليكم, it has been prescribed to you. طيب, hear me, prescription. كتابا موقوتا, that this is duty, that it is must on every, in every person. طيب, those prior times are time pointed out by Allah, by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, through this word or his deeds, in the sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in many ayat, if you notice that, Allah Azza wa Jal always, the first character of the believer is what? After believing? After believing is what? As-salah, iqamat as-salah. Look, for example, at the surah Al-Baqarah. In this great surah, after the opening, you know, Fatiha can serve as the opening surah. Like the opening of the book. And then come to the basic subject, the main subject. So the first surah, which is Al-Baqarah, subhanAllah, look to this order in the Quran. It started by telling or classifying people in two or three groups. There are believers, disbelievers, and between. Man, either he's a believer or disbeliever. This is very clear. And there are people who are munafiqun, hypocrites, who show belief and hide kufr. Surah Al-Baqarah started the first five ayat by talking with about the believer. And then seven or few or three or four ayat talk about the disbeliever. And many more verses, more than 10, to talk about the hypocrites. SubhanAllah. قال عز وجل ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. Okay, this book is guide for whom? المتقين, righteous people. Who are they? الذين يؤمنون بالغيب. This is the first thing. This is what we consider as the belief, faith, iman. What come next? وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَةِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَةِ, and they establish prayer. And this is another point that I would like you to turn your attention to. You'll never find in the Quran any verse which command us to do salah, to say sallu. Sallu does mean pray. But always the Quran said aqimu salah. يقيم الصلاة وأقم الصلاة. Establish prayer. والذين يقيمون الصلاة, those who establish prayer. That was it. Maybe we find somebody that said, no, there is the Quran, there is Allah عز وجل said صلوا. What did Allah said صلوا? Allah عز وجل said صلوا when it said about دعاء only. Like, إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا. Is this regular prayer? Sallu alayhi wa sallam wa taslima. That's me make dua for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Muhammad. So here sallu. But when it's come to the salah, regular salah, Allah Azza wa Jalla said what? Always said, wa aqimu salah. Establish prayer. Right? Why? What is the difference between sallu and iqamatu salah? Iqamah, that's mean establish, that's mean this salah should be established on firm pillars and foundation. It's not just a matter of movement that people do, no. And this, inshallah, this is what we'll go to speak about. Because the salah consists of what? Of shurut. It's come before we started. Conditions consist of pillars, which is the foundation of the salah, pillars of salah. And wajibat, obligatory acts, and sunan, and optional acts. This, inshallah, will come in our discussion. Anyway, look at here, and establish prayer. وَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ قُلْ عِبَادِي يُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Tell my servant, قُلْ عِبَادِي يُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Establish prayer. Anyway, this is all, mashallah, you are familiar with these ayat. All this, the Sheikh mentioned many of these ayat just to emphasize the importance of salah, and mashallah, alhamdulillah, you are aware of this. Moreover, when a woman, so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, young boy, who was innocent, does this one have to be performed? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, and you will have reward. This, the Sheikh quote this dalil to show you that by, you know, helping or emphasizing or training your children to do their duties toward Allah Azza wa Jal, also you are sharing in this reward. My dear brothers, you don't know how much good you do for yourself when you teach one person how to pray. Even your children. Because as long as this child, even he grow up and then he taught his children to pray, all his prayers and those that he trained, all will be in your scale. So this is why when you take good care of your child, train him for salah, you are benefiting him to raise him as a good Muslim. Okay? And at the same time, also, you get high reward, and this also clear your side from any responsibility or taqseer. طيب. So here we talk about children. The Sheikh said, so a guardian, either, why say the guardian here? Because either the, if it, either he's a father or a mother, or sometimes, especially for the orphans, his uncle or his older brother or anyone who was taking care of him. This is why he didn't mention, he specified the father. ولكن ولي الأمر. ولي الأمر. طيب. Teach his child how to perform salah and how to perform wudu. A guardian has also to beat his child if the latter is 10 years old and neglect prayer. So this is here the rule. The Prophet ﷺ said, command your children to perform prayer when they become 7 years old, and beat them for not performing the salah when they become 10 years old and arranged. Anyway, look at this hadith. Do you think that you will need, just think about this. Do you think if you kept for 3 years telling your child every day and every time, pray, do you think you will not pray?
Inshallah.
No?
You will pray,
for sure.
For sure.
Just imagine 3 years and every year more than 365 days. Huh? And this 365 days, five times, just multiply it, see how many times, and then multiply it by 3 years. Every time, subhanallah. If it's a rock, you know the rock? If you come with your finger every day just doing like this, you will make a hole there. Yeah, subhanallah, yeah. Look to the water, the rock. If there's a water, a drop of water. If a drop when it's coming, come put your hand, mashallah, it's nothing. This way. But this drop, if it stay for the whole year, dropping, what will happen? You will find, subhanallah. So here's the point. So if the guardian, in fact, they take good care from the beginning, he will not, he doesn't need to, you know, to move to the next step. Right? Unless, you know, after these 3 years, that's mean this, this child, he needs shaken, you know, because some people, they, you know, people are different in their personality. Some people are physical. I mean, they physically oriented, they call them. Right? Physically oriented. They don't understand through abstract, but they need something to shake them. This is why sometimes they use this reason. Right? This hadith related by Tirmidhi and Abu Dawood and their compiler. It is also impermissible to perform salah later than its due time. My dear brothers, you know, unfortunately, and some Muslims, they delay the salah for many different reasons. In fact, there is no excuse for delaying the salah, till the point that if the person was in a situation and he is afraid that the time of the salah will be expired, طيب, and he didn't meet certain condition, all these conditions will be waived. Let's say, for example, a person and a desert in any place that he want to make wudu, but there's no water. We tell him what? Make tayammum. There's no way. Salaam alaikum. No way that he can make tayammum. Let's say, for example, as an example, there's a Muslim prisoner in the hand of the enemy, and they tied his hand and legs. He cannot move. And the time of the salah come, and he doesn't have enough clothes to cover him. And he's afraid that the time of the salah will expire, then he can pray on the same, whatever condition he can, even without wudu, or even without having any clothes. What does this mean? To show you what? The importance of salah on the prescribed time. That even some ulama like Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, he said, the one who missed the time prayer, there's no need to do it. No need to do it, because it's not be accepted. The time is finished, over. This is one view, not all. But the important thing here, to show you the importance of performing salah on prescribed time. So we'll stop here, because our brother, Shaykh Abu Hudayfa, mashallah, arrived, we're waiting for you. Do you mind I take some questions? شيخنا ونايف ابغاك
في فقه الاسلام مشكور رحمه من جاي من قديم
دكتور ابو ابو نايف تحتاجك بس دقائق تعال سريع طيب سريع كنت تعطيني دقائق طلبوا كويسين. What's your question, Abdul Hadi?
I'm going to take the problem in the process in the group. It's about the postnatal labor and the last part. And I'm going to put in the... some just question is we are going to avoid because there is some...
طيب, okay, that's good. That's good. طيب. Yes, yes, yes.
Sheikh, you
might
address this next week. You can address next week this question because of matter of time. There is an issue about salah and the issue of so if somebody is a Muslim or not, and if it's, especially in the West, becoming a big problem because there is an issue caused to the division of our community, and there is certain people who live the lifestyle of Muslims and they live different lives and drugs and they don't know. They die, and finally, bring them to masjid for janazah. There is one point Sheikh said no. One of friend of her. You can address this
situation. Maybe inshallah maybe in detail, if it might just remind me and we'll discuss it at the beginning of next week. Because it's very, very important. Thank you for Allah khair and our brother.
I'm going to